So today we have Mike Kwasniak. He's from Suffolk. Am I saying that right? Suffolk, England. And he is going to be talking about using your camera or using your iPhone as your camera, which is something that I've done. He decided he went on a holiday vacation for us United Staters, went on a holiday and just decided to take his iPhone instead of his camera. And he had... apparently he really liked it. So he's going to tell us about that and some of the tools that he uses, including Halid, which is an awesome app, a third-party app, but it's awesome. So I am going to turn this over to Mike, and it's all yours, Mike.
Thanks very much, Dan. Mm-hmm. Right. I don't know where to start, really. A warning, the first 10 minutes or so of this presentation is going to be pretty technical.
We don't see Mike. Mike is not spotlighted.
Yeah, I'm working on that right now, trying to figure out where you unspotlight somebody. I'll remove spotlight, big old button there.
Okay. Have you got me now?
I'm still now.
Not spotlighted.
Yes, you are now.
Oh,
yes,
okay.
We got you.
Good-o. Thank you. Mm-hmm. I'm going to spend quite a lot of time today talking about raw photography. And I know that there'll be some of us who don't know what raw photography is, so I'm going to make it absolutely as clear as I can. It does mean that for about 5 or 10 minutes, things are going to get a bit technical at the beginning, but please don't let that put you off, because after that we'll be diving into the app and having a look at it and seeing how it works. Let me tell you a bit. This is a bit of a long story, but it's quite important. 3 years ago, we were in New York doing a long Broadway weekend, and we had a fantastic time. But it happened to coincide with the release of the then latest iPhone, which was the iPhone 11. And I decided I was going to buy one, because I'd been invited to Walt Disney World in Florida by friends who are DVC members. And they very kindly said, it's your 65th birthday. We are going to treat you. We are going to provide the accommodation, and we are going to have fun. And I just thought, for the first holiday ever, I really couldn't risk taking a camera. I'm sure, like most of you guys, I've been used to carrying a camera on holiday for eternity. First of all, a little Kodak Instamatic, then a 35 millimeter camera with roll film in it. Then a posh 35 millimeter camera with roll film in it. Then I went digital in 2000. And so it was a digital DSLR. But they're really heavy, and they're really difficult to carry around in places like Walt Disney World, because, of course, you can't really take a thumping great 35 millimeter camera on a roller coaster. So I decided, because the news was so good on the photographic quality of the iPhone 11, I decided that I would buy an iPhone 11 Pro Max, the biggest, bestest, and see how I got on. And so let me just share my screen. Just preempting any early questions about stuff that I'll be covering later, this is what I hope to go through this morning with you. So we're going to talk very briefly about the RAW format and get a bit technical, as I said, but not for long. Then we'll have a look at Halide, which I think is a sensational app. It's relatively inexpensive. It's much, much better than the camera app that iPhones are provided with. And I'd really recommend it. And I hope that after you've seen my demo, you'll understand why. I'm going to take a really short look at a sort of sister app called Spectre, made by the same developer. It doesn't do very much, but what it does is really quite beautiful, I think. Then we're going to jump out of this keynote presentation, and I'll just show you briefly how I handle my RAW files once I get home from holiday and what I do with them. I've then got a short film which I'd like to share with you, which is just under 5 minutes and just has lots and lots of pictures taken with my iPhone 11. And thank you very much indeed, Mitch, who I'm sure is here today, but Mitch very kindly provided me with a Pro RAW file from his brand new twinkly iPhone 14 Pro Max device. And I'd like to just share that with you and just talk about the advantages, but also about the possible disadvantages of the iPhone 14 as far as photography is concerned. So let's just talk about RAW and exactly what it is. I love, this is an amazing, amazing image. It was recorded by a famous American photographer called Jeff Shewe. He very kindly gave me permission to use it during my demonstrations. And Jeff went out with his scientist hat on to just push RAW photography to its absolute limit to produce the worst imaginable image that was still rescuable if it was photographed as a RAW file. And so this is the image that he presented us the world with. And you can't even tell what it is. But if I just click my mouse button, all of this information was in that image that you saw a moment ago. So that image contains all of the information that Jeff needed to create this. So RAW files have big advantages, but also some disadvantages. The biggest disadvantage is that RAW files are big. So you need a lot of memory in your phone if you're going to start shooting RAW, particularly if it's with an iPhone 14 because of the file sizes. Now this, just to give you an idea, this is the best that I could do with a JPEG of that original image, and it's rubbish. You still don't really know what it is. So there's a massive, massive difference between shooting RAW and shooting JPEGs. Some of my friends shoot JPEGs when they're on holiday, but when they're working professionally, they always shoot RAW. I guess my advice to most people, most friends, would be if you're shooting something really important, shoot RAW, because the amount of work that you'll spend processing images is far outweighed by the quality that you'll get from the images. A really good example would be a wedding. If you aim a camera at a bride, for example, wearing a great big white dress, the exposure will be incorrect because the camera won't read it as white. It'll read it as mid-tone gray. And when you correct that image in Camera Raw, it just looks great. Whereas if you correct that image in as a JPEG, it won't look so great. And I'll try and explain why in a moment. So here's a real world example of mine. This was taken on a holiday in Thailand, and I purposely underexposed this shot by, I think it was three stops. I can't quite remember, but two or three stops. So it's very dark. But I recorded it twice on the same camera, once as a JPEG and once as a RAW file. So this was the original. And this is the RAW file once it's been corrected. So once that exposure has been hiked up from being two or three stops too dark up to its proper exposure. And you can see it's got a lovely soft range of tones, certainly from my memory of this day, this event. They're very accurate colors. And so the next shot is the same shot, but recorded as a JPEG and then corrected by two stops. And the difference is absolutely huge. It looks cold, it looks flat. The colors aren't very nice, and let's just nip back. So that's the RAW file that's been corrected through two or three stops. And that's the JPEG that's been corrected through two or three stops. And here's a close-up of a small area in those images. And one of the biggest differences, if you do accidentally underexpose a shot, for example, if you're at a wedding, you photograph the bride on automatic exposure, the dress comes out mid-tone gray, so you have to pull that exposure up. Look at the difference here. Look at this pillar and how clean, relatively, it is. And look at all the color noise in the JPEG. It's absolutely astonishing. And around here, the screen or whatever it is, you can see an absolutely massive amount of color noise. Now, yeah, you may be able to correct some of that in Photoshop or whatever editing app you use, but it will never ever look as good as the raw file. This is a picture. So this is a histogram. I'm going to assume that some of us don't know what a histogram is, but when you see what Halide looks like as an app, you'll understand that the histogram is really a really, really important feature. What this is, just a graph. It's a posh name for a graph. And what this graph is showing us at this point is black. And over here at this point is white. And it's showing us the distribution of pixels in a shot. So you can see the blue pixels, which peak just here. It's probably sky. We can see the green pixels here, and we can see the red pixels here. Anywhere where it's gray, there's an equal volume of both of all three. So there's no such thing as a perfect histogram because they're different for every single shot. If I took a shot of a sheet of black paper, all we would see is a spike here at the black end. Likewise, if I shot a sheet of white paper, all we'd see is a spike at the white end. But what we would hope to see generally is a graph that finishes in this corner, unless there's a quantity of black, solid black in the image. There is, in fact, in this particular instance, because it spikes right up at this edge, right up at this end of the histogram. And likewise, we'd like to see the graph just disappear down to a dot, which it does beautifully at this end. And what that means is that none of the whites in your image are going to be burnt out with no detail in them. And likewise, as long as this histogram dark end finishes down in this corner, there won't be any solid blacks, because anything that appears black will have detail in it. So there'll be shadow detail. And if you're a fussy professional or a fussy amateur, all of this stuff is important. Now, the first half of this histogram, so in other words, from the white point all the way back to here, covers one stop of exposure. So if you underexpose your image by one stop, there's just a chance there'll be no detail on this side of this graph at all. At the second stop of exposure, so you close down the lens by 50%, the second half occupies half of the remaining space. So that occupies this space. And then the more you underexpose, the less information there is for that appropriate stop of exposure. I really hope that makes sense, but I hope that the next picture gives you just an idea of how important it is. So what we're looking at here, and this is the last bit of technical nonsense, so relax. DSLRs, digital single lens reflex cameras, provide 12-bit raw images. And that what that means is that in the first stop, which is all of the brightest tones down to mid-tone gray, there are 2,048 levels of values available. In an 8-bit JPEG, because JPEGs are only 8-bit, there are just 69. If you underexpose by five stops, that 2,048 reduces to 128. So if you actually underexposed an image by five stops, when you try to fix it, you'd have to expand those 128 variations of color out to that amount. And obviously, that's why you get really, really noisy images if you accidentally take shots that are badly underexposed, because software just doesn't know what to do with it. It sees 128 variations of tone, but it's got to somehow or other create all of these, and it doesn't generally do a very good job of it. Down here on this bar graph, you can see that's the 8-bit JPEG, and all of this is what's provided by a raw image. So in a nutshell, what this means is that when the camera records, all cameras record raw images. I guess you guys have dollar shops in the same way that we have pound shops in the UK. Even if I went into the pound shop and bought a camera, it would still take raw images, but it wouldn't let me access them because it, in a cheap and cheerful camera, all that would happen is that it would record all of that data, and then the software in the camera will mash it all together and compact it and compress it and throw lots and lots of it away in order to present you with a lovely hopefully a lovely JPEG, which is fine as long as you get the exposure right. But as I said, if you make errors and if you want the freedom to play with the colors and stuff, if you start with a proper raw image, your images will have a much lovelier tonal range, much lovelier gradations of tone, and they'll make you a happy person. Not going to spend long on this. When this was just something I found on the internet, but when you record an image with your iPhone, all of these things are taking place. So the camera in your iPhone is incredibly sophisticated. And it's looking at the image, it's producing the best possible images, the best possible image that it can. However, for my taste, I don't like them. I find them a bit too sharp. As I'll demonstrate shortly, I find sometimes that where bright areas are combined with dark areas, you can definitely see halos around the joins, around the edges, that make them look a bit false and a bit weird. And I don't like it very much. So for all of those reasons, this year when I went on holiday, not only did I leave my camera at home, but I relied on my iPhone 11, which we're looking at the moment. And I'd read quite a lot about halide being a fantastic choice of app to use with the iPhone. And one of the biggest attractions of halide for me on this particular occasion was that it can shoot RAW, obviously. It can shoot HEIC files, which we're just used to now because we're shooting those instead of JPEGs. Or, and this is the important thing, you can shoot both. And I loved the idea that if I did that for the whole holiday, in every single instance, I'd be able to compare the HEIC file with the RAW file and make a judgment about which was best. And I learned so much during the 2 weeks of our wonderful holiday. So this is what the app looks like, and it's very familiar. It really doesn't look that different from the photos, the camera app in your iPhone. So up here we've got the image window, obviously. I spent a lot of time talking about the histogram because here you see there is a thumping great histogram, and it's impossible to overemphasize how important the histogram is. You could actually record this image and know that you've got the exposure right without actually looking at it, as long as you have access to the histogram. Because what this histogram is telling us is there's a white point on the right-hand end, and down at the black end, there's just a little peak there. And I'm guessing that that's probably this area at the side of my bookcase, because it's very, very dark. It's in deep shadow and it's very dark wood. So I have the histogram visible all the way through. Everything else on this is just pretty familiar, I think. So here we've got a button to turn the histogram on and off. Here we have a button to turn off this thirds overlay, which I don't recommend, because if you shoot using the thirds overlay and don't always put your subject right in the middle like I've done in this shot, it will improve the images. This is for your selfies, and this is for your portrait mode. It's set to autofocus at the moment, but it also has a manual focus facility, which is lovely. Of course, you can use any of your lenses. So there's the times two lens on the iPhone 11, and there's the times 0.5, the wide angle lens. Down here we have, I'm ashamed of this. I'm actually ashamed of this. I'm so ashamed. I meant to actually change it. Down here is the last shot that was recorded in photos. And this is a shot of my stomach and the contents of a drawer in the kitchen taken accidentally, and I should have got rid of it, and I'm sorry, but there we are. Now, in the middle of the tools, there's a little horizontal line just there, and if you just slide upwards from that, it opens a drawer which leads to a few more controls, and they're pretty obvious again. Here we have the flash, which we have control of, so we can switch it on or off. Here we can choose whether we photograph HEIC files or RAW files. Here we have a self timer, which provides three options. I think it's for 3, 5, and 10 seconds. So if you want to put the camera down on a stand of some sort and get in the picture yourself, you can set it to pause for 10 seconds before it records an image. Here we have white balance control, which is something you don't see in most other apps. And it's set to auto white balance, but it also offers options when you click on it for daylight, tungsten, all the usual sort of light settings that you have in your home. And by actually making a judgment and setting that correctly, particularly if you're using lighting, you'll get much better pictures than you will without. Finally, there's this cog, really, really important, this cog. And when I click on it, it takes me to this screen. And at the top of it, this is such a good idea. And I think more developers should do this. It's a fantastic facility where you just click on this box that says what you can do with Halide. You pop your email address in. You send it to the developer. And then once a day when you wake up in the morning, there's a tiny, tiny bite-sized lesson waiting in your mailbox to teach you to use the app. And it's fantastic. It's a single paragraph. It takes literally 2 minutes to read. But it means that after 10 days, you should be up to speed with everything else that there is to know about this extraordinary app. Under that, we've got a settings button, and this was, as I said earlier, this was really important for me on this particular holiday, because when you click on that, you get the option to shoot RAW plus, which is basically capturing a DNG, that's digital negative, which is a RAW file format. So it captures a DNG file and it captures an HEIC file. But we do also have the options to shoot just RAW, and we have the options to shoot just HEIC. I would love at this point to say I could just leave it on one or the other, but in fact, in future, I will have it set here daytime and here nighttime, and I'll explain why next. So that's it. It's really, really simple to use. When you record images, they get sent to your photos collection. Sheeta, did you want to interrupt?
Hi, Jim Tinsley had a quick question that you might be able to answer since you're talking about settings. Jim, can you please unmute yourself and ask your question?
Yes, I was wondering when you were showing the difference between the bit depth for RAW and for JPEG. You said that JPEG has a maximum of 69 levels. Why is it that low? I would have expected more like 256.
No. It's 256 across the whole range from white to black. But of those 256, the first 128 are all about that first stop of exposure from mid-tone gray to white. And then the second stop down is half that number. So that's my maths are terrible. I'm sorry. Half of 160. It's 60 something. Sorry, I'm going to melt. So with each progressive step down in exposure, you halve the amount of information.
Yes.
So you get masses of information for the first stop, which of course is the most, usually the most important stop. But then the darker the elements of the image go, the smaller the amount of information is available. So that's where you end up with the 69. Does that make sense?
Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you, Jim. All right, all yours, Mike.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. So raw files look really weird. This is a raw file taken on the little balcony of the gorgeous place we're staying in Walt Disney World. A beautiful place to breakfast. Lake, a big warning sign saying alligators, don't leave your balcony. and you'll see that it's pretty dark. It all looks really dark. And the reason it looks really dark is that what the raw file is attempting to do is capture detail in the darkest areas of the image, whilst also capturing as much data as possible in the brightest, brightest parts of the image. So as a result, they do it by creating a really flat file. So just about every single raw file requires some manipulation after the event. I happen to get huge enjoyment out of editing images, and I hope you guys do too. If you really can't be bothered, if you just want a quick fix, then just shoot HEIC. But let me show you the HEIC file that would accompany this file. It's fake. It's just fake. I really, really don't like it. And what I don't like about it is that there's a definite halo along this edge. There's a sort of bright, bright, bright. And it looks over-sharpened. It's cold. And it could do with a bit of warming up. And of course, all of these things are possible. But the one thing you can't change about this particular file is the sharpness. You can't get rid of those sort of halo-y effects. And the next shot I'll show you is what the processed raw file and how different it looks. It's warmer. There are no halos, unwanted halos. And for my money, this is a much more kind of realistic image, if that makes sense. So here they are side by side. So I've not been able to pull out quite as much detail in the clouds here, but I don't care. Because that's not important for me. But all in all, for me, this is a much more pleasing image than this is. And I mean, I hope you agree. Everyone's taste is different where photography is concerned. I'll bet we've all been eaten alive at camera club competitions. I certainly have, where I thought, I'm really proud of this, boys. Just look at this. And they've dismissed them. So, you know. This is Portofino Bay at Universal Studios, a fabulous hotel, absolutely beautiful. And again, this is the raw file. So we've got no detail or a very little apparent detail in the sky. The buildings look a bit bright, but not bright. The buildings look a bit dull from the image that I have set in my head, because the image I have in my head is of an incredibly bright, beautiful setting. So this is the raw file without any modification. This is the HEIC file. And again, I just don't see realistic here. Interestingly, the colors have remained rather dull. And it just all looks a bit false. Every time I see HEIC files of this type, they just don't look real. And this is my version, and which I much prefer. And again, you know, horses for courses, some people may not, but the colors in all of the buildings are much richer and much more like the colors that I recall from our stay there. So here's a side by side, and just look at the difference in these lemons. And these colors of the other, you know, hotel rooms. It's astonishing. I'm completely sold on this app. And I don't care that I have to spend a couple of hours at home working on images when I get back from my holiday. Now, where it falls apart is at night, because I don't know if it's Apple's name for it, it's the general term for it, but something called deep fusion. And this is built into the camera, into the camera app in your iPhone. And what deep fusion does, I believe, is it doesn't take one single image. It actually records 9 images really, really quickly and really close together. So you're not aware of it. And then it blends those images together. And absolutely in all cases, after dusk and into the night, the HEIC files, for my money, were better than the RAW files. And look at the sky, for example, which is really, there's no noise in the sky here. This is the HEIC file. This is the RAW file where there is some noise. I don't know whether you can see that on Zoom, but certainly there is. Look at the colors in the Mickey's of Hollywood sign. We've got these lovely, lovely rich yellows. And I absolutely could not create that from the RAW file at all. But I think that's because of this deep fusion stuff. I've tried this out using conventional photography because I often work with Affinity Photo, and one of the filters in Affinity Photo enables you to layer lots of images of the same. You don't need to they don't have to be on a tripod. You can hand hold them. But if you're outside at night, if you take 10 shots of the same thing and allow the Affinity Photo app to mold them together, you end up with no noise. And that's what we're seeing here, but we're not seeing here. Here's another example. The noise in the background here in the RAW file is extreme. And it's fixable to a degree, but why bother when you've got this? But, you know, this is, for my money, definitely a better shot. Look at the crispness and color in the sign. Look at the detail here compared to here. So in future, for me, as I said earlier, it will be RAW files during the day and HEIC files at night. Here's an interior on one of the Avatar extraordinary attractions. And look at the detail in this. I don't know what this is supposed to be, pump or something, but I've been just, you know, the detail is great here, where it's a bit of a mush here. And again, we've got a lot of noise around the perimeter of this shot, particularly across the top. And there's virtually none here at all. So really, really worthwhile experiment from my point of view.
So it's like bracketing at different exposures.
Yes.
Deep fusion, yeah.
It says, what is Apple Deep Fusion and how does it work? Deep Fusion uses the iPhone's processor and neural engine for its machine learning prowess. The phone camera takes 9 shots, 2 groups of 4, prior to pressing the shutter. And then 1 longer exposure at the point of press. That's I don't know. I don't understand any of this stuff. I just smile at it and try and use it. So before we move on to a practical opening a few files, let's just talk for just a second about Spectre. Oh, Halide, incidentally, Halide in the UK, and I think it's pretty much the same in the States because our dollar pound, sadly, our dollar pound is about the same at the moment. You can buy outright for about $40, or you can purchase it on an annual basis for $10. So again, horses for courses. Spectre is really inexpensive.
Can you answer 2 questions before you get into Spectre?
I will try.
All right, Lawrence Jenkins, can you unmute yourself and ask a question, please?
Yes, I made a mistake and I bought an iPhone 13 with only 128 So I heavily use iCloud when I take photos. Yep. Will this automatically upload to iCloud when you take the pictures?
I don't know the answer to that because I bought because I knew I was going to use it for photography. I just bought a phone with a lot of memory. I'm sorry, I can't answer that. I don't know if Sheeta can or anyone else.
I don't know.
I believe it does because it puts it into your photo library, and then once it's in your photos library, iCloud takes it from there and uploads it.
Right. Okay. Yep. Thanks, Dan. Thank you.
Thank you, Dan. All right, Jerry Schultz, can you unmute yourself and ask your question, please?
Yes. The deep fusion mode that you mentioned Apple uses, do you have to select that? Or
you have it
automatically when it gets dark?
Yeah, there's no access to it at all. It just switches in.
Okay.
Which is a bit of a problem, but I'll talk about that hopefully if there's time when we talk about the iPhone 14. Let's talk about Spectre. Spectre's amazing. So I've been to a lot of, particularly through lockdown, I spent a lot of time attending lectures given by the Royal Photographic Society here in the UK. And I saw some spectacularly beautiful landscapes. I live in a county that is completely flat. It's basically farmland, and we don't have any spectacular hills. We don't have any spectacular waterfalls. But Spectre comes into its own with lights and with water. And when we go hill climbing on our next holiday, I think I'll be using it a lot. It's very inexpensive. I think it's about $7. And as I said, I don't have any, there's nothing I could photograph to illustrate it, unfortunately, in my house. So I'm afraid you get an image of my armchair. But this is the app, and there's really nothing to it. So we have a button here. We have a dial here, which you can set between 3 and 9. And in the middle here, we have a little box with an icon of the phone in it. So the way that this app works is it takes multiple exposures depending on how you've set this dial, which is presently set for 5. So it will take 5 exposures of the same subject very quickly, one after the other. And during that period, it's essential that you keep your phone icon within the boundary wall of this box. Because what happens then is the app analyzes the images, layers them together in perfect so that they perfectly match each other, and provides you with this, which I just love. Because here's another shot, and here's that shot with its traditional shot. And again, I know I keep using this expression of horses for courses, but some of you may prefer the one on the left. I really love the softness of the water in the shot on the right. When we get into the Utah parks next April, May, I see me using this quite a lot on waterfalls and stuff, just because it looks so sort of dreamy and lovely. I hope you agree. But that's a steal. It's so inexpensive, and there's nothing to it. It is the simplest thing on the planet to use. There's nothing to learn. It's finding the subject, in fact, is the only difficult part, certainly if you live in Suffolk. Right, let's get out of Keynote and photos. So here's my photos library. I'm only going to spend a couple of minutes inside the photos library, but you can see that most of these images have JPEG plus RAW labeled in the top left-hand corner. And what happens when you export one of these images, I'm going to use this one just as an example. When I go up to the file menu and choose export, you probably already know this, but there are two options. There's an option to export one photo, but there's also an option to export unmodified original for one photo. And when I click on that, just let Photos know where I want to save it to, which is the desktop. I have two files, not one. So I have an HEIC file, and if I just do a quick command I on that, we can see that that's 3.8 megabytes. And I also have a DNG file, the digital negative file, which is the raw file. And that's 10.7 megabytes. So it's 2.5-3 times the size. So you really do need to be careful about storage. And if you're able to get stuff uploaded to your photo stream and to Photos straight away on a daily basis, that is the obvious course, so that stuff doesn't end up just completely clogging up what memory you have available. Let me just show you some raw images. Whoops. I'm going to do this in Bridge and Photoshop simply because I live in these programs, and like Sheetra, I can do it so much more quickly. But I prepared this folder with just a limited number of images in it. So you can see left and right in each of the pairs shows the DNG file and the HEIC file. What I quickly learned was that the flatter the images to start with, the less difference there is between the HEIC and the raw file. This is a good example. You can see that the sky is just a little bit bluer in the HEIC, but everything else looks pretty much the same. So how do you process them? Well, there is a problem here, and I really hope that Sheeta or Dan or somebody else might just say that there are alternatives to Photoshop to do this in. But I like being able to apply changes to multiple images at once. And although I work a lot with Affinity Photo, I work a lot with Photos, you can't do that. And let me just illustrate what I mean. I'm just going to change the sorting of these files. Whoops, sorry. The giant cursor is not my friend. So I'm going to just sort these by type so that now all the HEIC files are together and all of the digital negatives are together. I'm going to do a command A and just select them all. And then I'm going to double click, which will open them in Adobe Camera Raw. The next thing I'm going to do, which again, as I said, is something that I can only do in Photoshop. And if anybody knows alternative software that's cheaper than Photoshop to do this in, I would love to know. So Adobe Camera Raw will enable me to select all. So it's just selected all of those images. So now any changes that I make will be made to absolutely all of the images. And all I'm going to do is take the highlight slider and pull it all the way to the left, which will pull out all of the detail in the sky. And then take the shadow slider and do the opposite, which will brighten up all of those shadows. I am also, because I like it, I'm just going to increase the vibrance just to pull a bit more color into the shots. And after that, I will just work my way through them one by one and make the corrections that I want to make to each individual image. It's not difficult and it's not rocket science. It takes a bit of time, but as I said, if you enjoy it, why not do it? It's because it's just so simple. I'm just going to click on done because I don't want to spend any more time on this because there's really no point. And quickly move to Spectre just so you can see some before and afters. There weren't many opportunities in Walt Disney World. Oh, sorry. That's better. These need rearranging. Avatar. Perfectly ordinary, perfectly fine shot. Lots of water crashing around. But for my money, that's much more interesting. Actually, particularly in an environment like this, which is very kind of mystical and bizarre anyway. But it works so well. And you saw this one earlier. So if you have access to waterfalls, it works beautifully with lights as well. But I don't live in places where one can access that stuff. I don't want to stop the share. How do I get out of this? Like that. Quit bridge. Does anybody have any questions? So before I finish off talking about the iPhone 14 and the implication of ProRAW, if I may, I'd like to just share a 5-minute movie with you that I made from this holiday so that you can see a big bunch of these images. The music is mad. It's by Michael Giacchino, and it's from a film called Tomorrowland, which of course is Disney. I have to apologize if Sheeta finds it necessary to remove the music because it is copyrighted music. However, I shared this on the Suffolk site and they let it go. So hopefully they'll be kind and allow us to do that as well.
Okay.
Your full screen.
Mike, we don't hear sound. Do you have sound? Thank you.
Right. So, summing up, I won't be taking my camera anymore because there's just no point, because that pleases me enough. And there's absolutely no point in dragging a heavy piece of kit around, as far as I'm concerned, for future holidays, because the quality is absolutely fine. Let's just talk a bit about Pro Raw. Mitch very kindly sent me a single image over. So this is a DNG file. This is a digital negative RAW file taken with top of the range iPhone 14. But look at the size. Look at the size. You're going to need a huge, huge amount of memory if you're going to spend the entire holiday shooting RAW images. So it's no surprise that the storage sizes available for iPhone 14, I think, are bigger than they've ever been before, but it kind of goes without saying they need to be. Let me just open this image.
I should clarify that's a 48 megapixel. You can shoot 12 megapixel RAW files with the 14.
Oh, right. I didn't know that. Thanks, Dan.
Yep. Yeah, it's just 48 megapixel, which is, like you said, huge.
Sheeta.
I need to clarify something because a couple of people have asked this question. When you talk about the size of the files are not in memory. The files are on storage. We have someone asking about how much memory do you think you used? It's not memory.
Oh, yeah, I'm sorry. Yeah, it's not memory
that these files are taking up.
No.
Okay. Yeah. All right. Thank you, Mike.
I'm so sorry. Yeah. So, I've learned something because I didn't know that you could shoot 12. One important thing to point out here is that I took my first professional theater photographs with the very first professional Canon camera when it was released in 2000. And it was 3 megapixel, and everybody was delighted with the quality and the results of the images that they saw recorded with that 3 megapixel camera. The 5D Mark IIIs that I use today regularly every week are 24, so that they're literally half the size of the images that you can record with the iPhone 14. So, and I'm so glad Dan has just clarified that you can actually shoot 12 megs because it's perfectly big enough. The only reason I could think of to shoot 48 megs would be if you were gonna do some really, really outrageous cropping. I crop in camera. I mean, you know, if I wanna get closer to something, I use my feet. I don't need to go throwing pixels, precious, beautiful pixels in the trash. I'll just get closer to it, to the subject. I was really worried about close-ups while I was on holiday, but, you know, you quickly forget. And I absolutely couldn't be more pleased. What we're explain, what we're looking at here is Mitch's 48 megapixel image, but this is the DNG file, but it's already had all of that stuff. I have a note here. So in an article I found called "What is Pro Raw?" it says with Pro Raw, it's like a hybrid of Raw and JPEG or HEIC. When you shoot with Pro Raw, you're getting a 12-bit Raw DNG file with 14 stops of dynamic range. That's incredible, absolutely incredible. And Pro Raw format allows Apple to use its signature computational photography features while still giving us much of the pure data as possible to use in editing. So this isn't a true Raw file, because this has gone through the same dishwasher process that the HEIC files and the JPEGs go through. And whether that's a good thing or a bad thing remains to be seen. I actually genuinely don't know the answer. What it does mean is, though, that if you do decide to shoot Pro Raw, there's every chance that most, if not all, images when they hit your screen will already look fantastic. I mean, I've done nothing to this at all. And if you look at the camera raw settings down the right-hand panel here, you can see the white balance is as shot, which is, well, they're set below the temperature and tint. And then absolutely everything is set to zero. So I have done nothing to this file, all apart from open it. And I know that if this was an ordinary DNG file taken with my iPhone 11, it would look very different. The sky would be burnt out. Those deep shadows in the bottom right, left-hand corner would be very dark indeed. And I would have to spend some time tweaking to get everything back to where I want it. So that's just about me done. So if anybody has any questions, I'd be absolutely delighted to try and answer.
Mitch has a comment. Mitch, go ahead.
Yes, I just wanted to comment that you do have to turn that 48 megapixel setting on, and you do that in the camera setting area under the top one format, and then you can either leave it at 12 or you can turn it on to Apple Pro Raw and select. That's also where you have to turn on Apple Pro Raw to be an option on the camera. And then you can either select the 48 or the 12. And the 48 is only for the 1X lens. If you go to the 2X lens or the 3X lens, it's automatically back to 12. And that's all I wanted to clarify.
Have you used it a lot, Mitch?
No.
That's a shame.
I'll be in Florida next week, so I'll be able to try it out. I just got my 14 Pro Plus X Max, whatever.
No.
Mike, you asked about different apps. I want to mention a couple. Somebody brought up Raw Power app, which is actually made by the developer, one of the original developers of Aperture, Apple's Aperture. That is Raw Power. I've used it. It seems to be okay. If you read a little bit of history, Google Apple Aperture history, and it's pretty fascinating. That that whole development team was a cluster. Let's just go with that. But it's interesting. Another one that I've been playing around with is called Darkroom Plus. It's relatively inexpensive, $5 a month. They have Mac, iPad, and iPhone apps, works with your library, and you can do all the edit and batch. And the other nice thing about these apps, or at least with Darkroom Plus, like somebody asked about how much memory you need, it's always good practice to reject photos that you're not going to use, so then you don't clutter up your library.
And not memory, storage. Yeah.
Your storage, yeah. So what you want to do is with Darkroom Plus, you can easily reject photos that you do not want to keep. So then you can free up your storage, not your memory. So a couple tips there. Also, I'll end with a great tip on the Halid. Mike, I don't know if you know this or not, but if you're using iOS 16, what you can do is put widgets on the lock screen. And Halid updated their app to where you can put the actual camera app on the lock screen. So now in addition to having the camera app, Apple's camera app, you can now use Halid as from the lock screen, which is fantastic.
Which is brilliant.
Right. Okay, we have a Brian Silverio. Can you unmute yourself and ask your question of Mike?
Yes, thank you. When you're talking about the second app, that takes between I think it was 3 and 9 pictures.
Spectre.
Realize you have to hold the camera steady for that time. But then, how long is the processing time after that? In other words, how much does it slow you down?
I can't answer that because I suppose the fact that I wasn't aware of it taking any time probably answers the question. It's pretty quick, but I wasn't in any situation on holiday. One of the important things about, for me personally, one of the important things about particularly holiday pictures is I'm driven slightly mad by friends who feverishly take photographs. Oh, look, a person. Oh, look, a stick. Oh, look, a spot. Mm-hmm. Oh, look, a lamp. And they take thousands of pictures. And one of the people that I traveled with does it. And he openly admits he never edits them. And I kind of don't get that. I don't see the point. I don't see the point of taking 2,000 pictures when you can take 100.
The point is,
and be delighted.
I think the point is he believes in the theory of, you know, scatter shot, and at least one pebble hits you.
Yes. That was a very roundabout way of saying yes. So when I recorded one of those shots of the little waterfalls, I was in no hurry to kind of immediately take a further shot, but I certainly wasn't aware. And in fact, I could probably do it now. Please bear with me a second.
Sure. While you're getting that ready, Alan, do you have a question? Can you unmute your mic, please?
Yes, my question, actually a couple of questions, relate to the movie. Question number one, could you get the movie to blend from one picture to another rather than snap from one picture to another?
Yes, but that doesn't work very well on Zoom.
Okay, all right. Now, second question. If you have a caption in each one of the pictures, can you get that caption to show in the movie, only in the movie? Now, I know you could embed it in the picture, but only for the purposes of the movie. Is there a way that you could get the caption from the picture shown in the movie in each picture?
I think the answer is definitely yes, but it would be very long-winded, because I think the only way to do that would be to make the movie in something like iMovie or Final Cut Pro, and add titles to each of the images. So it would be very time-consuming.
Okay. Now, finally, every once in a while, almost every day, in fact, the Photos app on my phone picks a group of pictures and pulls them together and makes me a movie.
Yes.
I mean, did I set some kind of image, some kind of setting to make that happen, or does the Photos app just do that automatically?
I don't think you have any control of that. Dan, please correct me if I'm wrong, but I don't think you have any control over that. I think it's just an automated delight to surprise you each week.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right, Billy McKee, can you please unmute yourself and ask your question?
Mike, thanks for this. I mean, as you know, I've seen it before. One of the things that hasn't come up in this discussion is the iCloud storage requirements. I think if you're going to start getting these, 12s and 14s, and you're going to start having RAW, you'll end up with a shed load of images up there in iCloud. And I think you'll rapidly run out of space if you're not careful. I mean, I'm running at 200 and I put a 128 gigabyte card JPEGs in and nearly killed it. So, you know, as well as getting loads of storage on any devices you get, I think you need to look at the iCloud requirements that you've got and add to it, or look very seriously at it. The other thing that came up from that last presentation you did, and I think it was there and something else, is that if there are technical geeks in this audience who are into exposure and can follow up with the RAW stuff, there's actually a couple of apps where you can actually look at the actual RAW files, because there is a tendency from cameras, especially Sony's, to underexpose. If people are into that, they can actually look at their images and see what the actual histogram looks like and the loss. I think the important punchline is that you can actually understand why everybody says go for overexposure and filling and expose towards the right. You can see what it does. If anybody's interested in that, I can put it into the IO group later today, to that.
Yeah, please do.
Great. So I just took a photograph of an angle poised lamp while I wiggled it up and down because I could. And the processing time was about 1 second. And that was 5 exposures. So the 5 exposures, let me do it again while we're talking about it. So I'm pressing the button now and it's going 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, finished. and ready. It's that quick.
Okay. So Frank, can you ask the question that you put in the chat, please?
Yeah. Let me do that. Yeah, Mike. Why doesn't the smooth waterfalls that you have in those pictures, and I think you took them with halide, right? Or,
yes.
Yeah. Why doesn't that affect the same texture in the rocks, et cetera, when you do that?
Because you have to keep the camera, you have to keep the phone fairly still.
Sure.
As you've got this little icon that you need to make sure remains within the boundaries of a box, which is easy. It's easy. Mm-hmm. You'd have to be shaking like mad to miss it. But part of the procedure then is that all of the shots are lined up pixel for pixel.
Correct.
So because the rocks are solid, the rocks here are going to be lined up with rocks here, and they'll be sandwiched together, and they will absolutely match.
Yes, but the program is smoothing them. It's altering the...
But there's nothing color to smooth because they're not moving, I think.
Well, when you take it without that software, it's a crisp waterfall with all kinds of differences in color, shade, etc.
Yeah, but it's only the water that's actually moving.
Correct.
So it's smoothing everything, but there's nothing to smooth where the rocks.
Okay,
are.
So it's a smooth. Okay, I see. The smoothing function doesn't address color in the sense that it's not the photo.
No, it's only working with what's moving. Right. What's moving is the only element that changes.
Okay, good enough.
Okay,
thank you.
All right. With that, thank you, Frank. Okay, with that, we are going to wind down our presentation. Mike, I want to thank you. And I also want to say your reasons for taking only your iPhone were my reasons for taking only my iPhone this summer. And when I did all of the things for my presentation, I just did not want to carry around my DSLR. It just did not make sense to me. So I totally feel you on that. All right, with that, we're going to wind down, and I want to thank you, Mike. And we're going to hand this over to Dan so he can wrap up.
All right. Thank you, Mike. And if everyone can unmute themselves and thank Mike, that was great.
That was fantastic.
Thank you, Mike.
Really good. Yeah.
Thank you, Mike.
Great job.
Very nicely done.
Thanks, Mike.
Thank you, Mike.
A lot of good tips in there. And I'm with Mike and Sheeta myself, and I have not taken my cameras in several years. And I have thousands of dollars, I'm sure, like Mike does, sitting in my closet 5 feet away from me because the iPhone will do
covered in
just
dust
about as much as I want. And it's not perfect, but by far, that's the you know, your camera.
The advice is don't buy stock in Canon or the other camera makers.
Yeah. You know, as they say, the best camera is the one that you have with you, right? Mm-hmm. So there it is. Absolutely. The iPhone is always with you. All right. So thank you once again.
Don't invest in Canon.
Okay. Can you please mute your microphones if you're going to talk? Please mute your microphone. Thank you. Go ahead, Dan.
Yep. Next week, Next week, we are going to have Sheeta and Eckert talk about our classes, which are going to start in January. So you do not want to miss that. Got some exciting stuff coming up. If you like this kind of stuff, the classes just go into this kind of thing a little bit deeper. So a lot of stuff to learn. And again, if you know of anyone that could benefit from NMUG, Naples MUG, please, share our site and let them know, we'll be glad to help them out or anything like that. So check out the groups.io if you have any questions on anything. And thanks, everyone, and we'll see you next week.
All right. Be well, everyone. Take care. Thanks again, Mike. All right. Unless Eckert has something to say, we can shut it down, Mike.
The wonderful presentation. Thank you.
And right. Mike, check out that Dark Room Plus. I'm 20.
I'll have a look.
Pretty cool from what I can tell. So it might be able to have the solution that you need. It's not Photoshop.
All right.
All right. We'll talk to everyone later.
Take care.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you. Bye-bye.